Good morning, Vandam. Today we are going to learn some basics related to feature engineering. As you already know that for the classification purpose, if you want to select a good feature, that feature should have the following properties. Inter-class variance should be high and intra-class variance should be low for that particular feature. Then that is very good for the classification purpose. Let us look into dimensionality problems in machine learning or pattern recognition models. Curse of dimensionality. We require more and more training data as the dimension is increasing, as we need to estimate more number of parameters for estimating class conditional probability density functions. For example, consider this one-dimensional data. In general, we are representing input feature vector by x bar, right? X bar d cross 1 vector. D is the dimension of that feature vector, input feature vector. This corresponds to that particular d. D equal to 1 means x bar vector is 1 cross 1. D equal to 2 means x bar 2 cross 1. This is x bar 3 cross 1 input feature vector. For example, if the dimension of the data is 1, the one dimensional data, it means we are having only one feature in the feature vector, that is x1 alone. For example, we had done feature normalization, we had done min-max feature normalization so that our feature values are lying between 0 and 1 only. For example, in this case, this is 0 and this is 1. We are dividing this 0 to 1 interval into 3 parts. X1 feature can take any value between 0 to 1 after min-max normalization. Now, what we are doing is, in order to have that histogram estimation of those PDFs, probability density functions, or likelihood functions for different classes, we are trying to partition that feature vector space into subparts. And from the training data, we'll try to estimate how many samples are falling in this range, how many samples are falling in this range, and how many samples are falling in this range. After that, we'll try to normalize that one so that distribution will have unity area. This we already seen this in our earlier classes. Let's assume that we are partitioning that 0 to 1 interval into 3 parts, 0 to 1 by 3, 1 by 3 to 2 by 3, 2 by 3 to 1, 3 parts. It means that we need to estimate 3 parameters. We need to estimate this parameter, this parameter, this parameter. Here the parameter corresponds to probability that x1 belongs to 0 to 1 by 3. This is one parameter. Probability that x1 belongs to 1 by 3 to 2 by 3 is another parameter. And this is a third parameter. Probability that x1 belongs to 2 by 3 to 1. This is a third parameter. We need to estimate the three parameters in order to estimate that histogram for that particular class. It means for class 1, if there are two classes, for class 1 likelihood function, we need to estimate three parameters. And for class 2 likelihood function, or class 2 conditional probability density function, we need to estimate once again three more parameters from the training data corresponds to class 2. If that is class 1 likelihood function, we need to get the help of class 1 training samples to estimate the concerned PDF. If that is class 2, we need to construct class 2 samples to estimate this distribution. It means for each class, we need to estimate three parameters. If that is d equal to 1 in this particular example. And if you go for two-dimensional data, it means x2 cross 1, x bar 2 cross 1, that input feature vector dimension. And let's follow the same partitioning. After min-max normalization, x1 from 0 to 1, x2 also from 0 to 1. Now, once again, we'll try to partition that into three parts, 0 to 1 by 3, 1 by 3 to 2 by 3, 2 by 3 to 1. Similarly, the second feature, 0 to 1 by 3, 1 by 3 to 2 by 3, 2 by 3 to 1, 3 parts. Now if you look into this one, total how many parts we are having? Here we just have 3 parts, it means unit estimate 3 parameters. Here you are having 9 parts, right? 3 into 3, total 9, you can count this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Total 9 parts we are having. And you need to estimate 9 parameters in order to get the likelihood function for each class. Each class requires 9 parameters in this example. And if you go for d equal to 3, 3 dimension, x bar, 3 cross 1, feature vector, then you need to go for 3 into 3 into 3. 27 parameters you need to estimate, right? Suppose if you go for d equals to 100, x bar 100 cross 1, just with this kind of partitioning, you need to go for 3 into 3 into 3 into and so on. It means 3 power 100 parameters you need to estimate. 3 power 100 is very, very huge, right? That many parameters you need to estimate. And as you already saw that, the number of parameters that you need to estimate are keeps on increasing, the amount of training data required to estimate those parameters also should be so huge, right? You require huge amount of training data in order to estimate all these parameters. The dimension is increasing, the number of parameters you need to estimate also keeps on increasing by a huge amount, right? It means you require huge amount of training data. That's a problem with this dimensionality, right? That's why we're calling it like a curse of dimensionality. This is similar to last one. Here we have taken 3 partitions. Now we are going for 5 partitions in order to have the better accuracy to our histogram model of probability density functions. 0 to 1 interval, we are dividing this into 5 parts. This is d equal to 1, this is d equal to 2, this is d equal to 3. 5 parameters you need to estimate. Here you need to estimate 5 into 5, 25 parameters. Here you need to estimate 5 into 5 into 5, 25 into 5, 125 parameters you need to estimate. As the number of parameters are keeps on increasing, you require huge amount of training data in order to estimate the concerned distributions. The method of finding probability density function with the help of such kind of partitions or with the help of histogram method, it might require huge amount of data. In order to reduce the amount of data required, we are going for parameterized models for the conditional distribution functions. You are trying to go for some mathematical models where you want to represent that entire distribution with the help of less number of parameters. That's what your goal. Instead of going for these many parameters, what is our plan is, we want to do the same thing with the help of less number of parameters, that distribution estimation with the help of less number of parameters. For example, this is one dimensional feature vector, and if I am trying to model this distribution with the help of a Gaussian, for the Gaussian probability density function, if I know mean and if I know the variance, I can form that probability distribution function for the Gaussian, right? It means with the help of that model, Gaussian model, I need to estimate only 2 parameters. Instead of estimating 5 parameters, I can estimate only 2 parameters, mean and variance. And I can form that distribution function, right? That's the benefit I am going to get with that modeling with less parameters. That's the benefit, right? So that I can go with less training data as compared to this one. This is standard normal distribution with mean vector mu bar and covariance matrix sigma 1. here x bar is d cross 1 input feature vector. In order to estimate this probability density function with the help of our training data, we can estimate just mean vector and covariance matrix. That's more than enough. Once you got this one, this is straightforward, right? Standard normal distribution, or this is known as Gaussian distribution with mean vector mu bar and covariance matrix sigma 1. Here our target is estimating mean vector and covariance matrix from the training samples. Here dimension of mu bar is d cross 1, sigma 1 dimension is d cross d, and we know that sigma transpose equal to sigma. This is a symmetric matrix, right? Covariance matrix. So we need to estimate total these many number of parameters. D parameters for mean vector, d into d plus 1 by 2 parameters for covariance matrix. As the dimension of the feature vector increases, we need to estimate order of d square parameters. Why order of d square means, for example, if I go for d equals to 1000, this will become like 1000 plus 1000 into 1001 divided by 2. This is almost like a d square, right? The second term is dominating over first term. Almost like d square by 2. That's why you are taking it like order of d square. So as we increase d, we need more and more training data to estimate the parameter values properly. Because as d increases, the number of parameters you need to estimate also increasing at a rate of order of d square, right? At an order of d square. If you don't have huge amount of training data for large d, then our estimated PDF will be very bad and subsequent classification also will become bad. See, even if you apply minimum error classification rule, minimum error classification rule means that matching a posteriori probability rule, right? MAP rule. Even if you go for that MAP classifier, matching a posteriori probability classifier, which corresponds to minimum error classifier, we won't get best possible result. The reason is, see, because that MAP classifier is depending upon the prior probabilities and class conditional probability density functions, right? If I don't know exactly what are my class conditional probability density functions, then I can't get better results, right? Because that MAP rule is simply based on these distributions. My distribution itself is wrong. Whatever the distribution I estimated, if that itself is wrong, and if I try to apply for the classification purpose that MAP rule, then I'll definitely get wrong results only, right? That means in order to apply that minimum error classification rule, first of all, I should try to estimate the class conditional distribution and prior probabilities well, right? I should try to estimate them very well. If there is an error there, then I'll try to have classification error also a bit higher, right? Curse of dimensionality. If the amount of training data is fixed, as the dimension of the feature vector is increasing, then we may not cover the training samples which will model the true probability distributions of the classes. And this is the picture which will represent this curse of dimensionality. Let's assume that I have fixed amount of training data with me. For my classification purpose, I have some fixed amount of training data. Let's say I have total 20,000 training samples. Construct binary classification problem. And let's assume that the number of features, that x bar d cross 1, x bar d cross 1, where d corresponds to dimension, are number of features. if I keeps on increasing that d value, then I need to estimate more number of parameters and I require more and more data in order to estimate the concerned likelihood functions. It is showing that only that whatever the 20,000 training samples I am having, with the help of that 20,000 training samples, I may be able to estimate good conditional distributions up to the dimension, let's say for example d equal to 20. Let's say this is d equal to 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, like this. Up to d equal to 20, I can try to estimate reasonable or good quality likelihood functions or the conditional distributions. After d equal to 10, after d equal to 20, the dimension, if that is exceeding 20, I am unable to estimate the distributions well. If my distribution itself is bad, even apply map rule or map classifier, that Bayes classifier, I may not get good results, right? That's what you can see here. We are able to estimate the PDFs or the conditional distributions very well up to this point. After that, we are unable to estimate them. So this is the problem we are facing. This is due to lack of good enough training data. And you can think about why the performance is increasing from this point to this point. You can try to think about this. Then you guess why the performance is increasing from d equals to 0 to d equals to 20 features. See, the reason is, if you are having more number of features with you, that will give good enough information, right, for the classification purpose. For example, if you want to classify humans into two categories, like male and female. If you want to classify humans into two categories, male and female, in general, how to classify? Just by looking into the pictures, images. You can think about that one. Or how to detect whether there is a human face in the image or not. Whether there is a face of the human being is there or not in the images. How to detect that one? What kind of features you require? You may require some features which are relevant to eyes, and you may require some features which can identify nose. You may require some feature which may identify lips. You may require some features which may identify ears. You may require one more feature which may need to identify hair, like this, right? As the number of features are keeps on increasing, the information you are going to get also is reasonable for your classification purpose, right? If you are having more number of features with you, more number of relevant features, not irrelevant features, if you are having more number of relevant features for the classification purpose, it's good for your classifier, right? They should be relevant. If you have only one feature, for example, hair color black, right, in general, if you are having only that as a feature, with the help of that single feature, you can't say whether there is a human being in the image or not, right? Just with the help of that hair color as a feature. In addition to that one, you require all these features, right, related to eyes, nose, ears, like this also you require, right? Yeah, that's the reason for this growth. And one more thing is, as the dimension of your feature vector keeps on increasing, the d keeps on increasing further and further, You may require more number of training samples in order to estimate the class conditional distributions so that you can do very good classification. That's required, right? This is a problem of dimensionality. In order to reduce this problem, what we can do is we'll try to remove the features which are irrelevant for your classification task. For example, you want to estimate the weight of a student, and let's say you are having two features with you. Feature one is roll number and feature two is height of the student. In this particular example, roll number is irrelevant for estimation of weight of the student. Height is relevant to your weight of the student, right? In this case, it's better to remove that roll number feature from this set. It means first of all, you need to identify the irrelevant features and you need to remove them from your training set, irrelevant features, so that we can reduce our dimension, right? And one more thing is, if two features are highly related to each other, for example, you have three features with you, x1, x2, x3, and let's say x2 equals to 2x1, x2 equals to 2x1, just 2x1. They are just linearly related, x2 equals to 2x1. There is a linear relation between x1 and x2, right? In this particular example, you don't require feature x2 at all, right? Because once you know what is x1, from there you can estimate what is your x2. x2 is just 2x1, right? They are highly correlated to each other, x1 and x2 features. Then no need to have three features with you. You can simply remove one of them. Either you can remove x1 feature or you can remove x2 feature from that feature vector. Instead of 3x1 dimension, you can try to make it like 2x1 dimension. That d equals to 2 instead of d equal to 3. This will try to reduce the dimension, right? That means you will try to remove redundant features also. Redundant means repetitive kind of thing. Some features might be repetitive. If you know one feature, you can try to get another feature from that. And then you don't require two features, right? You can try to reduce the dimension in that way. You will try to remove the irrelevant features for your classification task. And you will try to remove redundant features. Then you can try to reduce the dimension automatically. If you are reducing the dimension, you require less training data for training purpose. Let's look into the measure of feature relevance. Let us consider a classification problem where input feature vector is x bar d cross 1 vector, x1, x2 up to xd are the features, and the output target class label is denoted by y, where y can be one out of c class labels. Y can be y1, y2 or up to yc, c possible classes total. Mutual information is considered as a good measure of information contributed by a feature to decide the value of the class label. You might have studied this mutual information concept already in your digital communications course. It's a measure of information between X and Y, measure of common information between X and Y, how they are related to each other. If X and Y are highly related to each other, then mutual information will be high. If X and Y are less related to each other, if random variable X and random variable Y are less related to each other, then I of XY will be small. If random variable X and Y are independent of each other, totally unrelated to each other, then mutual information between them is zero. There is no information at all. If there is some relation between them, then mutual information will be some positive quantity. and it will be very high when they are highly related to each other, x and y. This is a definition I of x I comma y, where x I corresponds to ith feature in your feature vector x bar. I of x I comma y equals to mutual information between x I feature and the output label y is entropy of x I plus entropy of y minus joint entropy of x I comma y. Entropy is a measure of uncertainty, and let us denote this measure as score of ith feature. This is just a notation. S of x I equals to I of x I comma y. S of x I is score of the feature. If this score is high, it means that mutual information is high. Mutual information is high means this feature is much relevant for our classification task. You can have a look into this. Mutual information can also be written as follows. This is KL divergence between joint probability and marginal probability products. P of xi comma y, P of xi into P of y. P of xi comma P of yi are marginal probabilities. P of xi comma y is the joint probability. This scale divergence will be higher when these two are not equal. When these two are equal, this one is equal to this one, then the KL divergence will be zero. KL divergence will be zero. It means whenever these two are highly similar, then KL divergence value is very small. Whenever this one and this one are highly dissimilar, then this value will be a bit higher. The two are highly similar means, for example, let's assume extreme case where P of xi comma y equals to P of xi into P of y. That's possible only when xi and y are independent random variables. When these two are independent random variables, then these two will be equal. When these two are equal, then KL divergence value will be zero. If you want, you can cross check here. Replace P of xy with P of x into P of y. These two gets cancelled out. Log 1 base 2 is zero, right? It means when these two features are independent of each other, this ith feature is independent of output class label, independent of output class label, then KL divergence between these two will be zero. We want high dependency between feature, our input feature, and the output class label. We want high dependence. We don't want independence between xi and y. If this value is higher, then that particular feature xi will be more informative about our class label y. And measure of feature redundancy. We don't want to have two features to be highly related to each other, right? We'll try to eliminate redundant features. They are highly related. If feature x1 and feature x2 are highly related to each other, we'll try to remove one of them. Unnecessary dimensionality, right? Feature redundancy is based on similar information contribution by multiple features. Some similarity measures are correlation based methods. We'll try to look into Pearson correlation coefficient, which you might have already seen in probability and statistics course. Cosine similarity measure. Let us consider we have n training examples with us. Pearson correlation coefficient between ith feature and jth feature is as follows. Rho of xi comma xj equals to covariance of xi comma xj divided by square root of variance of xi into variance of xj. That can be written as this, where xik corresponds to kth training example ith feature value and xi bar corresponds to the mean value of ith feature across all training examples, all n training examples. This is irrespective of class. We are not considering whether that belongs to class 1 or class 2 like that one. You see, for all training examples, including all classes together. Similarly, xjk corresponds to jth feature value of kth training example. Xj bar corresponds to the mean value or average value of jth feature across all n training examples. The correlation coefficient will lies between minus 1 and plus 1. The range of this correlation coefficient is from minus 1 to 1. Rho of xi comma xj equals to plus or minus 1 or magnitude of rho. It means mod rho equals to 1, for example. If mod rho is nearer to 1, then we can try to say that those two features are highly linearly related to each other. They are perfectly linearly related to each other. If this correlation coefficient is 0, it means that those two features don't have any linear relationship. They are not linearly related to each other. Generally, for all feature selection problems, a threshold value on mod rho is adopted to decide whether two features have adequate similarity or not. For example, they will try to assign this mod rho. If that mod rho is greater than 0.6, for example, where 0.6 might be the threshold in this particular example, if that is exceeding 0.6, mod rho exceeding 0.6, then they will try to say they are highly related to each other, and they will try to remove one of those two features because almost they are conveying the same information, right? One of them might be irrelevant feature for your class, not irrelevant, redundant feature. We have some pictures for that correlation. Let's consider this is xi, x coordinate is xi and y coordinate is xj, xi, xj, like that. In this case, they are linearly related to each other, right? Xi and xj, they are trying to form a line, you can see, ith feature and jth feature. They are simply on a line, on top of a line. Here, correlation coefficient equals to minus 1. And here also they are forming a line, right? In this case, correlation coefficient equals to 1 plus 1. It's some sort of, if this is increasing, this is decreasing, right? If this is increasing, this is also increasing. Here, r equal to plus 1. This is rho. Rho equal to plus 1. Rho equal to minus 1. and in this case they are not linearly dependent. Hey, that is linearly dependent, right? Perfectly linearly dependent. Here you can't form a line with these points, right? You can't form a line with these points and training samples. You can't form a line xi and xj. Here r equal to 0, or this rho equal to 0. Zero correlation between them. There is no correlation at all. They are highly independent of each other, these two features. Here rho equals to 0.5. Rho equal to 0.7, rho equal to minus 0.85. You can try to have the intuition by looking into these figures. Here there is more linear dependency as compared to this one. There is some spread is there, right? Spread of data is there, more spread. That's why this is 0.5. This magnitude is 0.85. This is so high compared to this, right? And when coming to this one, they are perfectly forming a line. Here the mod rho is 1. Mod rho is 1 here. And cosine similarity measure. Let's consider we have n training examples with L. Let us represent ith feature value in all n training examples in the vector form as follows. Ith feature value in first training example, second training example, and ith feature value in nth training example. We are trying to form a vector, n cross 1 vector. Similarly, jth feature we are trying to arrange in the vector form, n cross 1 feature vector. Then the cosine similarity between ith feature and jth feature is as follows. Cos of xi bar comma xj bar equals to xi bar transpose xj bar divided by norm xi bar into norm xj bar. You might have seen this already in vectors, right? It is something like angle between xi bar and xj bar equals to cos inverse dot product between xi xj divided by norm. Cosine similarity measures the angle between xi bar and xj bar vectors. If cosine similarity has a value of 1, then the angle between them is 0. If cos theta is the angle between xi and xj, if cos theta equals to 1, that's possible only when theta equal to 0, right? Angle between xi bar xj bar is 0. It means that they are overlapping, right? Angle between xi bar and xj bar is 0. And let's assume that xi bar xj bar both are unit norm vectors. Why I am saying unit norm vectors means we are doing normalization, right? This corresponds to xi by xi norm xi. This corresponds to xj bar by norm xj bar. This is having unit norm. This is also having unit norm, right? Because we are normalizing by norm for each of them. When the angle between two unit norm vectors is 0, then you can say that they are identical when they are unit norm, right? They are similar, highly similar to each other. If the cosine of the angle between them is, if cos of xi bar comma xj bar is 0, then these two are perpendicular to each other, these two vectors. Cos 90 is 0, right? Then you can say that they are independent of each other. When two vectors are orthogonal to each other, or when two vectors are normal to each other, or perpendicular to each other, then you can say that they are linearly independent of each other. They are not dependent. They are linearly independent. Which means that those features will not share any similarity. when theta is 90 or when cos of that angle is 0. It means that we can call it as a redundant feature when cos of the angle is nearby 1. Then you can call it like a redundant feature. Thank you.